Hello, everybody. First of all, thank you for the opportunity of being here to present some of the work we've done in Greece regarding the IPv6 deployment. My name is Georgios Manousakis. I'm a network engineer. I am the technical project management and architect for IPv6 deployment for mobile. So I'm going to focus there. And I decided to change a bit the way of presenting the work we've done rather than going step by step on what we did by talking about some of the challenges we dealt with. First, a few words about the company. Since 2015, we use a common brand name. This is that Cosmote thing. It's common for all fixed mobile business services, whatever. And it's the services that are being offered from OTE group of companies. We're merging the fixed and mobile, as a lot of companies do nowadays. OTE group of companies has presence in three countries, 21,000 people, and offers all kinds of services, fixed, mobile, TV, hosting in data centers, services to other operators, anything. The company has presence in Romania and Albania, and of course in Greece, where it's the leader in all services that the company offers, fixed, mobile, and TV. More than 50% for subscriber are chosen our network. Since 2009, if I'm not mistaken, the group is a part of Deutsche Telekom Group, and currently DT holds 40% of the shares. So, challenges. The need for IPv6. First of all, we needed to persuade ourselves that we need to do something about it. It wasn't easy, and it's the first, and it's no coincidence that it's the first. During 2010, we started discussions about this. There was no commercial drive. Sorry, there still isn't. There was no push from the vendors. Sorry, it wasn't. No special differentiation of the speed. Even the colleague from Facebook said that they measured differences without being quite sure how to explain that. Which is useful if you find the way, tell us, it will be helpful. And there was no action from competition. That's important as well, in order to persuade people that you have to persuade. Because not all companies are like you. on the other hand, we had to deal with public IPv4 shortage. 2012, RIPE changed the policy, exhaustion of public resources, last 8. The mobile subscribers are increasing very rapidly, more or less doubling each year, and I'm talking about the concurrent connected subscriber. I'm not talking about the SIM data, the SIM base subscribers, because there's practically static there. It's all the population have one or two SIMs. We wanted to avoid any further short-lived CapEx investment. Someone mentioned earlier, I don't remember who, sorry about that. We also want to stay with the CGN we currently have and just close it when everything will be V6. It's not easy to work with companies together and try to persuade them to use, a common new IPv6 address scheme. When you cannot do it for your own company, imagine a group of 10 NATCOs. It was a perfect example of what you mentioned earlier. It didn't work. It was very difficult. It is very difficult to handle with the house that we're dealing with the private address space reuse. We also thought it was a good idea, as you did, Nick, for new services, voice over LTE and Internet of Things. And we wanted to be compliant with the authorities. This is very important. At least we used it very much to persuade our management, because this is an actual need. When the authorities ask for a matching, we have to reply somehow, and either we have to go and investing on login platforms that will be useless, or we should do, or we should do something else, or at least present a different solution, a different approach. So that's what we did. Okay. The project was eventually started, but it was a technology-driven project. So it has the lowest possible priority in order to avoid any risk, because nobody would want a voice outage because some guys in the networking department are playing with something to have something in 5 years that might be useful further in the future. But we had a lot of time and a lot of weekends to think about and adjust the requirements for the new infrastructure to come, to spread the preparation and the upgrade through a much bigger time window. We allowed engineers to have time to gain awareness, even if some of us don't have before. It's true. And we wanted to take the opportunity and use this this new need to optimize the network architecture in order to have faster implementation for new services, more efficient operation and maintenance, increase the scalability, and reduce complexity and costs. Second challenge, dual stack versus IPv6 only. It's a huge discussion, especially in mobile operators. We will disagree, Nick. We went with dual stack. IPv6 only was well defined back in 1999 in 3GPP specs for the mobile environment. V4v6 was rather new back then. It was introduced in release 9 on 3GPP specs in 2010, but we chose dual stack. First and more importantly, because we didn't want any prerequisites from other departments. We didn't want to mess with IT. We messed with IT, but not in that extension that could cause us problems. We didn't want the value-added services platform departments to be very involved, and we didn't want to mess with services like TV and so on. You know, these kind of platforms, they're using radios to map the subscriber with the IP address in order to avoid the login screens and so on. So all this, of course, is V4 based. And we didn't want their delays to be part of our project. We also thought that going towards dual stack for the provisioning point of view would be helpful, because it would take one-time action, a pretty big one, but it would be for one time, and we could have all the features that we would want. We could go back to V4 only if something didn't work. We could go to V6 only, which of course is the target in the long term, let's say as the second phase of the project. And of course we could have dual stack over single bearer. We also didn't want differentiation on the terminals. We would have from day one two types of service, the V4 only and something else. And we didn't want to have V4 only, dual stack, something else with Android and 464 XLAT, which works great. And then have the iOS devices that don't support that and should be IPv6 only. We didn't want to have all this diversity because we didn't want to make things difficult for the people that would operate, that would handle the customer care calls. We want to be as simple as possible and future-proof. One more point. We wanted to be able to support all outbound, inbound roamers in Greece, the people that visit Greece. Sorry for the mistake. Greece is it's a well-known touristic destination. There are a lot of money involved in the roaming business, even after the change of the EU regulations last summer. So we wanted a setup that could support anything. So if we had a setup that support any kind of service for our subscriber, it would support greatly the same way all the roamers, without them having to try any other network. Of course, we had an emergency security valve, a deprovisioning mechanism to fall back to V4 only. we didn't know what was coming, to be honest. There wasn't that many problems, but it appeared to be helpful. I'll mention a couple of examples afterwards. Challenge number three, Femto over XDSL. Cosmote is doing business for mobile services, date back to from to 1998, so it's no green environment, no green field environment. During 2010, we introduced femtocells, 3G service over ADSL. More or less, I'm pretty sure you all know the idea. You have an environment with DSL and Wi-Fi access, but you don't have a signal from your mobile operator, so the mobile operator offers or sells a small 3G antenna that you plug on your router, and you get a small 3G coverage, a small cell in your environment using the ADSL access. We found out that IPv6 was not supported in that run environment. It was a complex signaling thing between SGSN and this run environment. Too much detail, I assume, to be more referenced to. The thing is that we got an access environment that dual stack couldn't work. By the way, V6 only was working there. So we talked with the customer care people and the commercial people, and trying to figure out a solution, how would we go on with that. Thankfully, nobody thought that this should be a blocking factor, and so it wasn't, and the project go on. But there was a case that we haven't thought of after going live. This solution was also offered to some corporate environments where there was no Wi-Fi coverage. So there was no alternative access method for the subscribers. We have to support them somehow. And the idea was to trigger the mechanism that was established, that was mentioned in two slides before. So we fold them back to V4 only on the provisioning systems. And that was helpful because we didn't actually need to tell the subscriber to change something in the settings of the handset. Of course, they had to contact us in order to identify who had the problem and make the change. But eventually, they didn't have to change anything. We had an agreement with customer care. They knew what they had to do. So we solved that. Challenge number four, more modern stuff, voice over LTE, voice over Wi-Fi. This year, these services were launched a couple of months ago, or even more, something like that. As you did, we wanted a clear IPv6-only solution for this service. That was the approach from the Evolved Packet Core and IP teams. We agreed having a dual-stack subscription on the databases. That was a desire from voice call from voice people. So we said, fine, we can go on with this. It's future-proof if something again went wrong, and it did. But we would have IPv6-only configuration on Packet Gateway and IPv6-only configuration on the IMS platforms. At least, of course, for the customer-facing interface. In theory, everything should work, and so they did, and more devices came, and problems were starting to appear. Something that I didn't mention, we went with native terminal support, no external applications. And this means that we have to work strictly with the vendors. That isn't very easy to deal with. So what the problem was? In a voice over LTE call, the device initially asked for a dual stack, that was the setup for the handsets, a dual stack connection for the IMS APN. The network allowed this request, but it was falling back the request to V6 only because that's what was configured. And it was working. The device was getting IPv6 address only. It was getting the proper PCSEF address to talk to the IMS. And the connection was working, the registration was working, and eventually the call was successful. But when they had to fail over from voice over LTE to voice over Wi-Fi, there was a failure. This is a diagram I got from a Cisco presentation. It was exactly what I wanted, so I didn't make it from the beginning. The active voice over LTE call is this one with the red line. And when the device was getting in a Wi-Fi coverage, it was contacting the EPTG platform. Yeah. Asking the EPTG to take over the call. But the device was telling the EPTG that since I asked for dual stack, I want you to find a dual stack connection to maintain. The EPTG was forwarding that information to Packet Gateway, but Packet Gateway didn't know about a dual stack connection because it only had a V6 connection. So in this scenario, what Packet Gateway was doing was dropping the call. Well, actually, it was dropping the PDN and thus the call. And it was initiating again the connection. It would work again if you press again the green button and make the call again. But the initial call was dropped, and that was a problem. Actually, that was a blocking factor for the service to go live. So there were three proposed solutions. The first one was to force the vendor to fix the firmware or the firmwares for several devices. The second one was to ask for the vendors to provide devices with only IPv6 only configuration for the IMS APN. But we thought that we couldn't handle all the cases there. So the third solution was make IMS APN dual stack, as it was the production APN for internet access. So the third solution was chosen. It was faster and it was easier. Indeed it was, but it was ugly because we really tried to have an IPv6 only service. This approach was abandoned really, really fast, to be honest. We delivered the service on time. The choice of dual stack provisioning on the database paid off because we used it. But we didn't use any private addresses in order to keep on going with the mess, especially in such an environment that we expect eventually millions of subscribers to join, because the voice will be handled all over in the future only over this access mechanism. So we used 0.0.0/8. Yeah. It's useless. We don't really care because this isn't announced in any IGP. I don't know even if you can announce it. We only trick the end devices that they have IPv4 address so they can maintain the call in the handover scenario. Practically, the service is still IPv6 only because all the communications is only pure IPv6. But it's a trick that wasn't really good. And again, this last bullet refers to theoretically whatever device might come in the future should work, unless of course it's V4 only, which I don't really think that there should be or there will be a case like that. Challenge number five, roaming. Well, roaming is one of the biggest differences between fixed and mobile, because in roaming you have cases where you have to support your subscriber or some subscriber, and not all the network that is underneath this path, the path of the service, is controlled by a single operator. So this seems to be tricky. I'm not going to get into details. Nick had a presentation last year or 2 years ago, I don't recall exactly, and he explained precisely what the cases and the problem are. I'm going to name what we did. So again, we stuck with our choice of dual stack, even if it was something new, both for handsets and provision systems. We thought that, okay, we are upgrading our mobile network at least once a year. So most probably everybody would be doing this. It's not something anybody enjoys, but eventually we want to have new services and new access networks to support. So eventually everybody will do it. So there's no point on stuck in that 1999 protocol just because it works now. inbound roaming, this is correct now, in order to check how our subscribers would behave when they're traveling abroad, we thought, okay, we cannot travel around all the countries and test, even if I tried as much as I could. But so we asked our roaming partners to do that for us. So we created a test list. We provisioned a specific IMSIs with the proper APNs and settings, and we asked them to do tests, all of them. Not everybody replied, but quite some of them, more than half of them replied, or even more, I don't recall exactly. We had some strange feedback. For example, back then, okay, I don't remember a lot of companies being having live IPv6 service, but there was one that I knew they had IPv6 only service, but they said, the roaming department said they didn't have devices to test. Okay. In general, we didn't have any issues. Only a couple of partners couldn't work, which was good because it proves that the idea of the test was correct. More or less, we decided that it was easy to go with roaming problems. Again, as the Femto users were calling customer care, and we did that tricky trick mechanism to fold them back to V4 only, we would do the same if something was very bad here. For the outbound roaming, again, the people that are visiting Greece and our network, everything was supported because it was already supported for our subscriber, and no problem. Again, just to be sure, we delayed go live as much as possible. I think that network should be ready by 2014. Yeah, I think it was in 2014. Yeah, but we didn't go live till 16. I will mention it later. But that wasn't the only reason. Anyway, the decision for the roaming for our subscriber was that we only will go live with terminals that could differentiate the access when they are in the home network and while roaming. In the home network, dual stack, in roaming, V4 only. Why to mess? IPv4 only works well. Sadly, when I try to connect dual stack from UK, it doesn't work. It usually doesn't work, sorry. So after 2 years of dual stack service, no practical issues were supported in for roaming services, that was good. Channels number 6, user equipment. This is the second biggest difference, if I may say, from the fixed world. Mobile operators, I don't really believe that they have leverage for the devices that are used in the network. The users might buy a terminal from wherever they want, either if it's tested or not. We don't bond the SIM with the handsets as they're doing in the United States. So if you plug the SIM to a valid to a device that has the proper network radio interface, it should work. And from my experience, I don't really think that you can persuade the vendors to change something. I don't think that someone managed to persuade Apple to introduce 464 XLAT. No, they didn't. Even they had tens of millions of subscribers to support. So in our case as well, some vendors provided devices with the settings unlocked, and we could use them at the beginning, even when the service was live. But the two biggest, okay, I'm not going to lie or hide, it's Apple and Samsung. Yeah, they had to approve the changes. They have to test that the service was proper before they allow the firmware to change in order to have this configuration. That took really, really long time. Because again, I don't think that they really cared. The feedback we had is that, okay, you know, guys, we have a very strict schedule. We have to deal with more important things now, but you get your time slot. So this delayed us and went hand in hand with the roaming case. And what the current status is, We announced publicly that the services, the mass market internet services dual stack, since last summer, August 2016. But of course, the preparation for the provisioning was from the beginning of the year. So throughout the year, more and more subscribers were coming, and they didn't know about that. There were devices with dual stack configuration from the factory. The subscriber didn't know, we didn't know. We didn't expect that we would have connected subscribers from day one, practically. But during August, everything was ready to announce it publicly. These are some stats I exported last week while preparing this presentation. The first one, the one on top, is the ratio of dual stack subscribers to V4 only. As you can see, there is an oscillation from 46% to 51%. Yesterday measurement was 52.07, I think. We can say that half of our subscribers are dual stack in the mobile service. The next diagram shows the IPv6 volume traffic over V4. And again, we can see that it's something like more than 30% of all our traffic is V6 only. If you do the math, again, I will agree, something like 70% is for mobile services, is IPv6 only, which is very good, because it more or less proves the approach we had years ago to invest towards this. It would pay it off, and I think it does, even it's maybe early. We have tools now, since we can measure that and know what kind of traffic we have to deal with. We can steer this V6 traffic out of the NAT box and offload it, thus giving it more life, which is very useful. The graph on the top is how this stat was evolved. It's V6 over V4. It's a different version. From January 2016, when we started, if you see that big change on the curve during March or April 2017, is when Apple pushed the new carrier settings, and the graph skyrocketed. Two more graphs from APNIC and the World IPv6 launch sites. They are in generally reporting a bit less traffic than we actually do. I imagine it is because, especially for APNIC, they're more focused in dealing with how fixed subscribers behave on their browsers and what they are doing. And the banners that pop up in order to count that. That's why I believe the results there are a bit lower than they really are. We also have some caching in our network, and that hides this V6 from the internet. A few words about fixed, because we are consolidating, so even if I was responsible for the mobile part, I know some things now about fixed. Fixed was way ahead. When we started talking about V6 in mobile, in fixed they had already pilot ADSL users. So I had something to play with till I go play with a bigger network. Currently the traffic for the fixed services is 40% IPv6. But we had to introduce a CGN solution in order to deal with a V4 shortage. I think this happened two or three years ago. It wasn't the original plan, but because we had delays with the firmware on the CPEs to support our IPv6 only choice, the solution we've chosen, we had to do something fast in order not to jeopardize the service to the subscriber. So the choice that my fixed colleagues made was a solution based on lightweight 4/6. I'm sure that you all are aware of the DS-Lite flavor of transition mechanism. What this does, this lightweight 4/6, if you haven't heard of it, unlikely, is the decentralization of the NAT function from this after NAAPT box on the data center to the CPE, which is a very, very useful tool to have. You can use Anycast in your network. You can scale better. It's much more better. And we are quite proud of it, because if I'm not mistaken, it's the first live deployment in the world that is using this technique. It must be having now something, maybe more than 10,000 subscribers. Country status, Veronica already mentioned something about that. It's not the only the work that is being done from Cosmote, mobile and fixed. There are also some companies in Greece, fixed companies. There is no work. At least we haven't seen any work from other mobile operators. And we have a pretty good footprint on the IPv6 adoption in the world map. 33.6%. Well, that should be all. Any questions? Now or afterwards? Okay. Oh, we have one.
Anthony is coming. It's very good.
I have a question regarding the roaming subscribers you are talking about. That, as you told, that you do not have the IPv6 working in as an in-guest environment in other operators. If you are talking about mobile subscribers, right?
Yeah.
How you are dealing with that, and what is the plan to implement this?
Well,
thank you.
The percentage of the customers of our customers that are using their devices abroad has of course increased after the change of the regulation, but it's still a very small portion of the subscribers that we deal with within our home environment in Greece. So it's only a small part that I believe eventually we will go to V6 only there. When we would have V6 only for our network as well. But currently, the idea was to start having a service, start giving dual stack access, let the people know about that. I mean, not the customers, we, the people that work in that environment, know about that. And as we see the trends moving towards dual stack, then we will consider the well-known, tested solutions for V6-only deployments. So the idea is to go V6-only in general, of course, no other way.